No, that's, that needs to be there, that's meant to be there.
Thank you.
I
Good evening. We will begin in a moment. The choir will sing the opening verse, and on the second verse, if you are able, please stand and join in from the second verse of Once in Royal David City. Like to be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Holy Trinity here in Barrow-upon-Soar. It's good to welcome you all here for our annual carol service. And it is particularly good to welcome the choir of Leicester Cathedral, along with their organist, David Cowan, their director of music, Chris Overy-Johns, and also Canon Alison Adams and Canon Emma Davies, two of the cathedral clergy. You're very, very welcome. It's such a joy and a pleasure to have you here with us. And it's a joy to look around and spot some familiar faces from Leicester Cathedral in the congregation. It was my church for 13 years before I was ordained. It's a particular pleasure for me to be welcoming you here today. And we believe this is the first time Leicester Cathedral Choir has been to Barrow-upon-Soar in the history of this church. So it's good to have you here with us. some very practical announcements, because the church wardens won't forgive me if I don't mention that if there is an emergency, please remain where you are, and the church wardens will direct you to the nearest exits. We actually have 5 exits in this building, most of which you can't see, so the nearest one may not be obvious to you, so they will direct you to the correct exit in the event of an emergency. If you do need the toilets, they are through the glass doors in that corner and just across the corridor. And afterwards, you are all very, very welcome to stay for mulled wine and mince pies, which will be served in the Trinity Rooms, which is our rooms just through to that side of the church, again, through those glass doors. So please do stay for mulled wine and mince pies afterwards, and an opportunity to congratulate the choir. We won't stop along the way for to announce each hymn or carol on each reading. It will simply flow through without interruptions. Please, if you are able, then do stand for the congregational choirs when we all sing, and do sing along and join in. Please be seated for the readings and everything else in there. There are prompts in the book in case you get confused. Hopefully everybody has got a copy of the order of service and can see that. If not, do indicate to one of the wardens and they will do that. I'm sure you're aware that a building like this doesn't run itself and doesn't run for free. We do need your help. We are affected by the cost of living just the same as everyone else. And so there will be a collection during the hymn, As With Gladness, Men of Old. We value your support to help us keep running and to meet the ever-increasing costs. So we thank you in advance for your generosity. We have our annual crib service on Christmas Eve at 5:30, an opportunity for all the family, particularly for children. It's always good fun, our crib service, and you'll be very welcome to that. Midnight Mass will be here at 11:30 on Christmas Eve, and there will be a 10:30 a.m. service on Christmas Day. If you want details of any of those, then there are leaflets at the back of church which you're welcome to pick up. I'm going to invite Canon Emma to come and join me. We'll move to the lectern so that you can use that microphone.
Thank you very much indeed, Clive. On behalf of Leicester Cathedral, my colleagues and the Dean Designate there, I'd like to say a huge thank you to all of you here at Holy Trinity for inviting us to come and to join in this service with you today. We have the senior girls and songmen of our cathedral choir with us. You may be aware the cathedral was closed for nearly 2 years for a large building project. We're still building another building outside it. We've recently reopened, but during that time, we went with choir and clergy to a lot of different churches in the diocese. It's been an absolute joy. It's part of our Together with Leicester Cathedral project. And I'm delighted to say that we want to continue doing that as much as we can over this next time, even though we've reopened. It's all about relationship. I hope you've got a little pin badge offered to you on the way in. And we've got a scrapbook at the end. We'd love it if you would sign that on your way out. But we always take a gift with us when we come, and it's a gift of a candle to symbolise the fact that we are joined together through prayer and through faith in Jesus Christ our Lord. So we've been praying for you. Please do continue to pray for us, and I hope that our relationship will continue.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you. So we're going to place that onto the altar for this service, and we're going to light it as a reminder that we are together, we're one diocese, we're one church, united in Christ, and it's a joy to share together in ministry. Thank you, Emma. And so, our formal words of welcome and our opening prayer. My brothers and sisters, in the name of Christ, I welcome you. We have come together as Christmas draws near to prepare for our celebration of the birth of God's beloved Son. Through the days of Advent, we have followed the light of Christ, and now we travel in spirit with Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem, to acclaim with the multitude of the heavenly host the coming of the Prince of Peace. Through scripture and silence, prayer and song, let us hear again the wonderful story of our redemption. And hearing, let us rejoice and respond with lively faith. So let us pray. Almighty God, you make us glad with the yearly remembrance of the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that as we joyfully receive him as our Redeemer, we may with sure confidence behold him when he shall come to be our Judge, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first lesson.
The prophet foretells the coming of the Saviour. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulder, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless praise for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Thank you. salutem hominum, tu posa celi fata, medela crinum.
The angel Gabriel salutes the Blessed Virgin Mary. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child will be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the word of the Lord.
The King of Peace by Christine Wilger. A king is coming, stock and stem of David's house, of his pasture born and bred, root and branch to be renewed. God's spirit will rest on him, reverence and godliness, governance and graciousness, the scepter of fragrance and fellowship. He will dress himself with justice, not seemliness and appearance, but compassion for the poor and oppressed, humbling the proud and powerful. Peace will mantle the earth, the end of injury and harm. No longer predator and prey, rather children and heirs of his kingdom.
Mary visits her cousin Elizabeth. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has looked with favour on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty away. he has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. And Mary remained with her for about 3 months and then returned to her home. Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son.
Oh,
St. Luke tells the birth of Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. This is the word of the Lord.
The shepherds go to the manger. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favours." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
the wise men are led by a star. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
somewhere there's a cunning on and off switch, but I can't for the life of me find it. Never mind. First, I'd like to thank you for being here to celebrate the reason for the season and for being part of the resistance movement to the merely Yuletide midwinter festivities. Secondly, I'd like to apologise to Reverend Clive, who in great faith and optimism put down a word for Christmas. It's good to live in hope, but it's not going to be rewarded this time. But if you were looking for just one word, just one, it would be the word home. I want to speak tonight not to the you who walked into church this evening, but to the real you, who is often hidden from public view, but is the you God loves most about you. The you to whom Jesus comes, not just today, or on every December the 25th, but every day. So as we're seated, we pray. So may I speak, and may we all hear only what is in the name of our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I wonder if some draconian law were to be passed, such is our pathological fear of immigration, that we should be required to report to our original hometown. How far would you have to go? Perhaps for you it's only a few streets away. Maybe the next county, which isn't that far from here, or country, or even continent. If any travel at all is involved, by the time you get there, it will no longer seem like home. It may involve, since donkeys are no longer de rigueur, a drive. So there will be at least a chance to play what my children will tell you is my favourite Christmas song, Chris Rea's Driving Home for Christmas, which appears to be set in America, but actually describes his real journey from Abbey Road Studios in London to his native Tyneside. He was driven by his wife, who had acquired a Mini, to go and pick Chris up because he didn't even have enough money for the train fare home, and he thought his music career was in ruins. When they arrived home, there waiting for them was a cheque for £15,000 from his US royalties, enough then in the Northeast to buy a house. So in the song is that telling line, I'm driving home for Christmas, yeah, get my feet on holy ground. In my case, the journey would be to the Royal Borough of Tunbridge Wells, TN1 2BD, not that they had postcodes then, way back in the last century, but almost as swanky a postcode as, well, Bethlehem. But it's just not home anymore. On the journey with me would have been another person. For him too, it just wasn't home. His parents were Irish, and that's where his heart lay. In fact, he was most known for writing a dubious and fanciful Christmas song. The title of it is now touring as a musical after being a West End hit show. The late Shane McGowan, born in Pembrey, almost as good as Tunbridge Wells, and mostly known as lead singer, songwriter for the Pogues, died, as you may be aware, on November the 30th. I saw the show and sang that song in mid-November in Nottingham, my alma mater. It's called, of course, Fairy Tale of New York. You know it best, perhaps, from the chorus. And the boys of the NYPD choir are singing Galway Bay. And the bells are ringing out for Christmas Day. Why would hard-bitten American cops be singing that particular song? The last verse gives the clue. And if there is going to be a life hereafter, and faith, I'm sure there's going to be, I will ask my God to let me make my heaven in that dear land across the Irish Sea. Their longing was for a home they had never even known, merely known of by imagination and reputation. So here we are, almost another year further away from what we have come to celebrate as a special birth. The fact that you're here this evening suggests that you go along with that theory, and that it just wouldn't be Christmas without celebrating the improbable story of a man-child whose coming was meant to change everything, but surprisingly hasn't yet, given the wonder of the story, made a difference to all the world's woes, and that we still long to see resolved, not least in the land of that man-child's birth. Jesus, as the Christ, belongs in heaven, but travelled in utero from what would be a long time in the future, his Nazareth home, to the city where by human descent he was from, the promised son of the great but flawed King David, in order to become the flawless great David's greater son. There is a winsome but unlikely tradition in a Syriac gospel and also in the Quran that Jesus was born able to speak from birth. Were it true, I fancy his first words might have been, "I'm home." They, from Pliny the Elder onwards, say, home is where the heart is. And the adult Jesus himself said, God loved the world so, so much that he gave the one and only begotten Son. So what is this fascination with the longing for home? What is it that we really seek? What makes it home for Christmas? For you? I do so hope it will not be for a saccharine celebration, a godly groundhog day, where this special arrival is robbed of its true message. I hope too that you are not here as a preemptive penance for imminent self-indulgence. I hope rather that you are here to try to imagine what it was really like back then, to recapture the vision of how it, the world, how we are really meant to be. St. Paul wrestled with that longing after home. To the Corinthian Christians he wrote this: even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. Or heard. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling. For while we are still in this tent, we groan under our burden, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. My paternal grandmother lived with us in her latter years and had her own bed-sitting room and a fund of gospel songs, one of which she would sing in a quavery octogenarian voice, "I nightly pitch my moving tent a day's march nearer home." Our hope through these readings and carols is that you will be captured by the Spirit who comes to take up residence in our lives. Now, hang on a minute. Didn't I just say that Jesus made his home here? His nickname was Emmanuel, after all, God with us. You know the carol, "He came down from earth to heaven, who is God and Lord of all." So what are St. Paul and Nanny Richards doing heading in the opposite direction? They could do so. We can do so. You and I can do so precisely because Jesus came the way he did. He came as we all do, with the need to be loved. So as we travel home to the manger, the place of sustenance, to the child who comes saying, "I will love you," will we love him? The introduction to the Christmas liturgy begins like this. I do hope you'll have an opportunity to come and hear it on the day itself, as it were. A simple one-verse poem. "Welcome all wonders in one sight, eternity shut in a span. Summer in winter, day in night, heaven in earth, and God in man. Great little one whose all-embracing birth brings earth to heaven, stoops heaven to earth." It is the most easily understood, yet profound mystery that we come to share in the divinity of Christ, through him who humbled himself to share in our humanity. That's why I said at the beginning, I wanted to speak to the real you, the you who is often hidden from public view, but is the you God loves most about you. Of course, he loves us, each of us, warts and all. But he comes to, as St. Paul put it, that inner nature which is being renewed day by day. So are you longing for home this Christmas? Longing to be at home in your own skin? Longing for a new kind of kingdom where our weary earth more resembles heaven? Longing for this truth sent from above to eradicate the scheming deceit of those who cling to power for their own avaricious ends? The answer is ridiculously simple. Open your heart. To misquote Paul and Linda McCartney, "Someone's knocking at the door. Someone's ringing the bell. Do me a favor. Open the door and let him in. He'll be at home, as will you." Open your heart. Just open your heart. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Father, your Son, our Saviour, was born in human flesh. Renew your church as the body of Christ. Holy God, hear our prayer. There was no room for your Son in the inn. Protect with your love those who have no home and all who live in poverty. Holy God, hear our prayer. Mary, in the pain of labour, brought your Son to birth. Hold in your hand all who are in pain or distress. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
Your Christ came as a light shining in the darkness. Bring comfort to all who suffer in the sadness of our world. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
The angels sang peace to God's people on earth. Strengthen those who work for peace and justice in all the world. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
Shepherds in the field heard good tidings of joy. Give us grace to preach the gospel of Christ's redemption. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
Strangers found the Holy Family and saw the baby lying in the manger. Bless our homes and all whom we love. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
Heaven is come down to earth and earth is raised to heaven. Hold in your hand all those who have passed through death in the hope of your coming kingdom. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
Christians the world over celebrate Christ's birth. Open our hearts that he may be born in us today. Holy God,
hear our prayer.
Father, angels and shepherds worshipped at the manger throne. Receive the worship we offer in fellowship with Mary, Joseph and the saints. Through him who is your word, made flesh, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. We pray together in the words our Saviour Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
St. John unfolds the great mystery of the Incarnation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
observant among you will have noticed that some knitted figures have appeared on the altar. I'm going to let Canon Allison explain.
Well, these are some of several sets of knitted figures. We call them posada, and they travel around the community going into people's homes. We've got here Mary and Joseph and the donkey. And a lot of very kind people have knitted these, and we have distributed them, and we hope that people will take them into their homes. And as Simon was preaching, in so doing, take Jesus into their hearts. And so they have landed, this set has landed on your altar table. So, will you take these figures of Mary and Joseph and the donkey into your home and give them safe lodging?
We will.
May they be to a symbol of you, to you, of taking the Lord Jesus into your home and your hearts.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as we prepare with joy to celebrate the gift of the Christ child, embrace the earth with your glory and be for us a living hope in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Thank you so much. Let us pray for God's blessing upon us all. May the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the wise men, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. My thanks to our resident organist, Richard Middlebrook, to our resident choir here, to Simon for preaching, to all those who've read, to our church wardens, to Jenny and our team who are at this very moment warming up mince pies and mulled wine for you all, just a reminder. And a special thanks to David Cowan on the organ, Christopher Ouvrey-Johns conducting and directing the choir of Leicester Cathedral, Canons Emma and Alison. It's been such a joy to have you all here with us. It is customary that we do not applaud acts of worship, which is what this is. However, I think we might break that rule and show our appreciation to the choir. What is customary here, however, is that even though Christmas has not arrived yet, not for another week, we take this opportunity to wish one another a Merry Christmas. And we do so by singing "We Wish You a Merry Christmas." And as we do so, we look around and turn to one another and wish each other a Merry Christmas as we sing. So hopefully Richard's going to play.